Good afternoon, everyone. Yeah, it's really great to be here. I know all of you have busy schedules, so do I. But I always like talking, interacting, learning from really young, vibrant India. That's what I see in front of me. Everyone is young. I think I'm also young at heart, so there is nothing. Just because I have 25 years experience doesn't mean I'm old. Okay, so I just want to say one thing, David. In this presentation which I have for you, I am not going to share with you some of the things of transformation in the travel industry or the hospitality industry. I'll actually share with you some of my experiences over 25 years across industries. Yeah. And some of them may be actually a little bit offline, because if you look at my 25 years, my first 15 years has largely been offline, you know, because that's what the world was. Last 10 years has been offline and online. Yeah, so that I just want to set the perspective and the expectations, and happy to answer any questions, whatever little I can, as a manager, as an entrepreneur, maybe as a consultant, any things which you guys want to ask, happy to answer that. So largely to give a perspective, why I have put it here is that I am fortunate that I have had the fortune of working with some of the large companies, brands. I started my career with P&G. First 10 years I have worked in sales, marketing, brand management with P&G, Reckitt Benckiser and Pepsi. In fact, 20 years ago I was in Chennai. I was a marketing head for South, Chennai South, you know, for South Pepsi. And it's a kind of return for me after 20 years back to Chennai. I've been around 8-10 months back to Chennai, yeah. And last 19 years I've been working various cities within the country and outside. I think Chennai has transformed. A lot of things have changed, I think for the better. Yeah, so it's a kind of homecoming for me. It's good. And I, those days I still remember. Very interesting, and I keep on sharing. For Pepsi, we did a thing called first time where there was a, you know, TV call-in program called Pepsi Ungal Choice. And we actually created one lady called Uma. You know, so she became a celebrity later on. Some of the younger people may not know, but some of the people who goes back 20 years will remember Pepsi Ungal Choice. So it was quite, you know, for me, it's a kind of homecoming coming back to Chennai. Yeah. So my first 10 years have been in FMCG. My next 10 years have been again in a fairly sunrise industry at that time called telecom and retail. So I worked in Vodafone, I worked in Reliance Communication. I was the first CMO of Reliance Retail. In fact, lot of experience I got when we actually set up each of these brands and businesses and formats called Reliance Fresh, Reliance Super, Reliance Smart, Reliance Digital, Reliance iStore, lot of experiences. And some of my experiences which I gather on e-commerce is oftentimes from my understanding of retail. And my last 5 years I have been in what is called the digital industry or digital vertical. So I have been with housing, I have been with a company called Apps Daily. They have a very interesting model. You know, it's basically how do you market online digital products in an offline manner. It's a very interesting model. And in fact, one of the slides I'll talk of it, that in India, at least in the next 5 years, I see what is called omni-channel or multiple ways of consumption being there. So I think most industries will have multiple channels or methodologies of consumption, whether it's online and offline. And now I'm in hospitality, travel. We call ourselves a holiday lifestyle company. That's what we are trying to reposition ourselves. So this is just to give a, I have also been fortunate enough to kind of co-found and found some startups. So if I think there will be a few startups here, I presume. Is that correct? Okay. So now, of course, the definition of startup and non-startup may be, it'll be slightly hazy, because large companies want to work like a startup. So the thinking has to be that of a startup. And startup companies have to organize and structure like a large company. So it's often changing, but I've been fortunate to myself found, co-found, invest in some of the startups in various fields. You know, so whatever my personal experiences, and in this case, unlike in the previous case, where The investment was not mine. Investment was of the multinational parent or that of a promoter. In this case, it is my investment. My money I have invested. So that also gives some experience. So whatever, I'll try to share that with you. Yeah. Okay, a little bit of thing on Sterling I want to say, because that is important. Sterling, we are now part of Thomas Cook, and which is the investing company is called Fairfax. It's a Toronto-based investing company across the world, around $50 billion of investment in various fields. In India, Fairfax has kind of invested and taken over Thomas Cook, Sterling, Nature Trails, which is now our subsidiary. It's another resort company. SOTC, Kuoni, Travel Corporation of India, Lux Asia. So a lot of things have been taken over in the travel industry, though each of the brands and businesses are operating fairly independently. Of course, we have our internal synergies. So one thing on Sterling I want to say, apart from the fact that we have 26, 30 resorts and we are growing, is that for many of the audience here, what is Sterling? Can you tell me one word? Yeah, timeshare. What else? Anything else? I'm just kind of getting a top of mind answer, as it is called. Top of mind, you know, TOM. Holidaying, okay. Anything else? Huh? Brexit, why? Sterling, okay. Sterling pound, okay. Any other things? Sorry? Yeah, yeah, that's of course there. There is in fact a company in Kerala which is also called Sterling. I met the MD recently. So essentially what he said is right. Lot of perception around Sterling is that it's a timeshare stroke vacation ownership company. That's what we think. But in reality, actually, half of our business is from vacation ownership. Other half is from what we call FIT, independent travelers. You know, hotel travelers, like any other resort you buy in. So actually, we have a very interesting model where we have a very stable and very interesting model. It's called a mixed model, where we have both vacation ownership people as well as FIT, or we call it HSD, Hotel Sales Division. So very interesting. So both are there and kind of 50-50, and both are growing. So that is one perception we want to, and therefore, in terms of destination, one of the roles for the marketing team, for me and rest of the team. In fact, I have Jay here, who is the head of digital marketing for Sterling. Yeah, so for all of us, essentially the role is how do we transform the company into a holiday lifestyle experience company? You know, so that's one of the roles which has been set. So we have to be holiday, we have to be a little bit lifestyle, and we have to be also experiential. So that's an interesting one. So I thought I'll just share with you. And Nature Trails is a new resort company we have taken over. It has around 4 resorts in and around Bombay, Maharashtra based. Yeah. Because one of the consumer insights we have seen is that today, unlike previous times, people don't necessarily want that long 15-day holiday once a year. They are more happy to have the easy drivable holiday from their city of whichever they work or stay. You know, so that's a very interesting, important insight. Okay, so again, these are the various brands which I have helped create. Unfortunately, a lot of them have been at this time when there was nothing called digital. It's only last 10 years that really what we are calling digital has come in. But I think I have a lot of understanding of how really some of the principles of business and marketing, according to me, may not really change on digital versus non-digital. So especially from the client side, when you are taking a decision, oftentimes some of the principles remain the same. That's why you are talking of ROI. I call it even ROMI, return on marketing investment. So sometimes ROMI will be slightly different from ROI. Yeah, so those principles sometimes don't change. Okay, so one concept I want to talk of, and I think all of you know, all of you are experts, is the concept of Uberization. Yeah, I purposely use the word Uberization because it's a well-known word. And I think across industries, this really will hit us. And as business owners, we need to plan for this. This is a direct impact of technology, of digital transformation of ecosystems, ability to do things. And a very personal example I'll give you, a very personal example, and this of course is very important in the travel industry. Travel, holiday, lifestyle industry, this is very important, because what Uberization does really is, you know, get your, make it asset light, make it easily scalable. You have different business models which an established player has to fight with or compete with. Yeah, and a very, and this is many, all of you know this, you know, what Uber has done and asset light, it incites entrepreneurial spirit. I think all of this is well known. But the personal example which I wanted to share with you is that I have been a resident of Mumbai for the last, whatever, let's say 10 years I've been a resident of Mumbai before coming to Chennai. And there was one brand which got launched, and it was invested by one of the private equity companies where some of my friends are there and we keep on talking. So that brand is called Meru. Yeah, so I don't know whether any of you have worked there, but very interesting concept, and I think they launched it quite some time ago before the Ola and Ubers came in. Yeah, and for customers like me, I think it was a good concept. You know, you have a different thing rather than the black and white or the company hired car. There is something in between which comes in. Fairly good value, fairly standardized, ability to order easily. Unfortunately, they got completely swept away by the Uber and Ola model, where they became a asset heavy company, because Meru's concept was actually owning the various taxis, yeah, and the asset. Okay, and they got completely swept away. Of course, they had their other set of problems and operational issues, which I'm not getting into. But in front of my eyes, I've seen a good concept, which was ahead of time. Unfortunately, a player came later and disrupted and removed them. Yeah. Now, of course, they are again now coming back, and they're trying to have the Ola Uber model. Yeah, but this is a classic example in front of my eyes, fairly personal in my city, I've seen. So this not only happens in this business, can happen in any business. So this is one, can anyone tell me what is one quintessence of success of Ola and Uber? What is the reason? Any of you are engineers will... No, technology is, according to me, a vehicle. But what is the real business reason for success? What is the problem that they are solving? Again, this is a little bit of marketing sales language. I'm saying, look at the problem. Look at it like a scientist. That's why I said engineer. What is the real problem? See, because all of you, any of you are startup. Sorry, just once. I still want you to go deeper. Absolutely right. I'm looking at it a little bit scientifically. Why it is important? Because many of you are startups. Huh? You will get your valuation and really your pound of flesh if you can prove to your investors that you are actually solving a real problem which is possible to be solved and which is scalable. Then the real valuation happens, because we have an advantage in India that we have that large market size. You know, we keep on saying 1.2 billion. Even out of that, if 200 million people, it's a very large market. Yeah. So I think this gentleman, what is your name, sir? Huh. So great. I think this is what it is trying to do, is very simple. You know, if you look at it scientifically, we should have a chocolate, huh, or whatever. But yeah, sure, no problem, absolutely. Yeah, please remember. Okay. So just let me elaborate a little bit. Yes, sir. Let me just elaborate a little bit. See, if you look at what is the core of the problem which is getting solved is, and I'm giving an example. In Adyar, you might have 30 cabs. Whereas if you look at in Besant Nagar, you might have 10 cabs, 5 cabs. Lying, as in they are parked. But the demand might actually be 30 in Besant Nagar and 20 in Adyar. Now, pre this technology development phase, there was no way of the customer and the supplier, the demand and supply, to match. So there'll be, it is what the technology is doing and what the concept is doing is essentially helping in matching the demand and supply. See, because by definition, Ola and Uber can never create supply. It cannot create more capex, you know. So within the existing capex, how do you match the demand and supply, which every engineer knows is essentially an effectiveness and efficiency issue. How do you increase effectiveness and efficiency? So that's what the technology does. And if you have any problem where you solve it like this through technology and which is scalable, then you will get that $1 billion, $2 billion, $3 billion valuation. Yeah. So I'm sharing with you, some of them may not look like digital marketing solutions, but at the end of the day, as a client, when you have to take decisions, some of these things help you in taking the right decision. Okay. The next one, which is again very close to my heart. Yeah, very close to my heart, and one of the reasons why I have got Social Beat as one of my partners is because I believe very strongly content is king. I don't know how much this is applicable in FMCG industry, but definitely in any industry where you have to take a little bit of decision which is an informed decision. And today, whether it's an electronics, mobile, data connection, consumer service, matrimony service, most of them, you are actually taking a little bit of informed decision. Definitely in travel, hospitality, lifestyle, consumer services. Even I was associated with a company called ISS High Care, which is into pest control. You know, it's a consumer service. Even that is an informed decision because you are trying to do something for your house. You want to be sure whether it's safe, secure, is there any ramification issues. So consumer wants to take an informed decision. Now, once consumer wants to take an informed decision, they have to have places from where they can get the information, stroke, if I may use the word, content. And today's consumers are extremely savvy and fairly skeptical consumers. They don't necessarily always go by only what you are calling branded advertising. Yeah, so people are actually looking at other sources of information which are not coming as an advertising pipe from the brand. They want other sources of information. In fact, this ties into the old tenet that which is the most powerful vehicle of communication in the world? Word of mouth. So what essentially content, social media to some extent does, it's like a digital word of mouth in some manner, you know, without getting into semantics. I'm talking at a very broad level. Content is king. And now if you go deeper into each category, so for some of your businesses, it might be different. Like in the case of real estate, we did a very interesting thing when I was at housing, is that we found out what is the decision making for a person when they are actually trying to buy a house for residence. Yeah. And we developed something called a housing lifestyle quotient, which essentially means that if he's thinking of buying a house in Nungambakkam, let's say, if he has a kid which is around 5 years old and has to go to a school, versus I have a kid who is in college, at the same place also the decision criteria might be different. So you actually have to help consumers in making some decision, whether it is through an algorithm, whether it is through giving information, whatever it is. So real estate, it's a big thing. I think in our business, which is about travel, holidays, it's a big thing. What I have noticed is that there's a spectrum of holidaymakers right now. Okay, let me ask an interesting quiz question. I just asked outside during coffee. So the person I asked, please don't say that. Which is the state which has the highest number of tourists in a year, this year? Great. Huh? Fantastic. I think everyone should get chocolates. Yeah. So Tamil Nadu. Okay. So if you look at it, I think, I don't remember, maybe a 50 million or 100 million, whatever the number is, you know, out of around 1.2 billion, some 700, 800 odd million actually travel every year. And these are domestic tourists, not necessarily international tourists. People do travel and go on holiday or wherever. So in this, there is a certain spectrum of travelers. So one end, there is to be a very conservative traveler, maybe 20, 30 years ago, for whom holiday used to be going back to their native land, going to the in-laws place or parents' place. That was travel. On the other hand, today you have travelers who only want to go to outlier destination. They are not interested in, that's why you see a lot of places like Ladakh and all really booming, you know, which are outlier destination. In fact, Ladakh is no longer an outlier destination because everyone knows. So there are a bunch of people who want to go to places which people don't know about. You know, like one of our destinations we created, very interesting, and that resort and destination has done extremely well. That's a place called Dindi. Anyone knows where is Dindi? We haven't done marketing well enough. We must do. Okay, so Dindi is a very interesting, it is basically the backwaters of Godavari in Andhra. So exactly what you get in Kerala, you get there. And very nice resort and not very far away. People from east and south both can go. It's somewhere in between. And it's backwaters of Godavari. So this is again an outlier destination. So from content point of view, what consumers would, you know, like to get today is not just the general fare. They want to even know about outlier destination. In fact, even in the general destinations like Ooty or Kodai is a fairly general destination for people from south. People would actually like to discover what is different in Ooty and Kodai which I can do. I just don't want to go to the Ooty Botanical Garden. There are quite a lot of things. You know, these are some of the old colonial establishments. There are a lot of trails which one can do. So again, from our company point of view, we are trying to do. And I think this is applicable for many businesses. Okay. I think many businesses have something called the inflection point. And this is where I think the role of the category leader, or I call it the concept of a category captain. You know, like for example, Flipkart has emerged as a category captain in e-commerce. You know, they are large, they are taking some decisions which are ahead of others. So for every category, there will be some category captains who can actually create inflection points. According to me, for example, COD is an inflection point for e-commerce industry in India. Okay, and even in the non-digital industries which I have seen, there are inflection points. For example, in telecom, I was in telecom in early 2000, actually in the year 2000. And two inflection points I have seen. One inflection point is called, previously incoming was not free. So that according to me is an inflection point. You know, people used to give missed call and then call up from some other number, whatever it is. So that is a big inflection point. That was of course driven a lot by regulation. But the other very interesting inflection point, according to me, was in mobile, GSM and CDMA technology, mostly mobile was in Europe and US. This is US was CDMA and Europe was GSM. Most of the business used to run on what is called contract. All of you know what is contract business in telecom? Huh? Can anyone tell me? Postpaid. So internationally, they call it contract. We call it postpaid. So most of the business used to be postpaid. And actually the emerging countries like India invented prepaid. And today if you see, it's a very interesting concept. It becomes affordable for the customer. From a company's point of view, it is great because you get the money upfront. Third important thing is anyone who is an FMCG marketer knows that moment you productize a service and actually make it into a product, you can do distribution in the large country. Service distribution is not that easy. Product distribution is easier. You know, because it can go everywhere, people can have a touch and feel. They know that this is 10 rupees, I'm buying a chota recharge, 10 rupees, physical product. So according to me, even telecom went through an inflection point. And each of you in your respective industries can, as business leader, think whether you can drive some inflection point. Yeah, and of course, I can get inputs about travel from all of you also. Yeah. The third point which I want to make, because of, and I'm talking a little bit more on e-commerce because e-commerce is a buzzword. Everyone is talking e-commerce and everything finally is e-commerce. one of the things we, and I have a lot of my junior colleagues who are senior people in Flipkart, okay, lots, so I keep on getting information, their changes, what is happening and everything. Oftentimes I've seen in many e-commerce companies and platforms and organizations, they're talking too much of the E and not talking of the commerce. Okay, fundamentally this is a retail business. So you have to understand the commerce, what the commerce is. And some of you are from retail. So anyone who is from retail understands what are the nitty-gritties of retail. It has to have product, it has to have an assortment, it has to have a merchandising, it has to have a planogram. In fact, yesterday only I was discussing with 5 minutes left. So quickly, a few points and I'll move. Okay. There's a very interesting concept. I don't know whether any company in India is today doing it. In the offline retail business, one of the key drivers, according to me, is visual merchandising, which essentially means how do you lay out your products and communication at the store to ensure there is offtake happening and product merchandising and product presentation offtake happening. Now, even in e-commerce, there's a big role of visual merchandising on your platform. I don't know whether there are any specialist companies doing. Partly some of the UI UX companies tend to say that I'm doing UI UX for it, but I don't know whether there's a specialist agency or a group of people. I think this is a very important requirement. Next point I want to make is that any firm which gets into platform creation, in fact the next slide will be a better one, is actually what commands a huge valuation. You know, so it is not just about transaction, it's about creating a platform. And from the investor's point of view, if this platform creation can be done digitally without using the physical reach or distribution of creating the supply side, then it is even more interesting. So it's like if all investors are looking for a hockey stick where you get it running and the digital wave will actually create the platform for you. Yeah, today not only demand, even on the supply side, people are getting people through the digital medium. So this is another concept which I wanted to, next concept which I want to say is, according to me, in the next 5 years, there will be a large amount of omni-channel in India and in any business. You know, and you can always take a decision as a business that I want to play only in one of the channels, that's fine. But as a category of consumption, there'll be omni-channel. App versus web, I think too much have been talked about it, but in reality it is nothing but delivery platform. You know, if I have to go back to Adyar, I can take a Ola, Uber or a auto rickshaw. To me, it's just a delivery platform. Of course, in terms of UI, UX, there are certain differences. To me, the mobile is actually a technologically more advanced because it has come 10, 20 years later. So there are a lot of inherent technologies which when you are building the UI, UX, you can build in. But as a businessman, it is two platforms to me. Consumer habits can be different. For example, what we call in the media industry, snacking versus dinner. So one can be a snacking platform, one can be a dinner platform. One set of people might only use the app. Someone is mentioning among the speakers that people are moving towards mobile. But as a country and as a category, if you look at it, my hypothesis is that both will remain. Next big one is about social stores. I don't think we have really used it well enough. Some of the social media platforms itself can become stores. And I don't know whether any of you are entrepreneurs here who run small fashion jewelry business. That's one business in India which does a lot of traction on social. So it's not through their web or anything, it's just run through social stores. And there again, technology can come in helpful. We all know future is AR, VR, I don't need to really say. In my industry, this is very important. In fact, this becomes important moment you move away from e-commerce of goods to e-commerce of services. How will you sell a service if you can't give an experience? AR, VR helps you giving an experience. Again, I think fairly lot of you are aware that in your web and your mobile platform you can build some of these in. Last one I want to, I think this is last or second last, so just a minute. Something called appropriate technology. This I'm specially talking for people who are have both an offline and online business. You know, sometimes, in fact, even to some extent in our company, we sometimes need to use only the best of breed technology. But sometimes maybe the appropriate technology is more important, otherwise we'll never get ROI. So it all depends on at what stage is your category. So I think the CMO, CEO, CIO, and the promoter's job is to really decide on appropriate technology, not get carried away by the buzzword that this is the best in breed technology. So I think this is my learning, it has been. And even within the industry, appropriate technology can be at different points of time for the different companies. It need not be same. Like for example, in year 2002 or 4, I implemented SAP ERP for an FMCG company when I was the head of sales marketing for a company called Balsara, Dabur. And Baba Ramdev Patanjali has implemented SAP 2 years ago. So it all depends. You know, it need not be always at the same point of time, but these are certain things when you need to do it at the appropriate time is very important. This is at a slightly strategic level. This will be very important for people who are sitting with money and spending money. So the head of marketing or the CMO or whoever. How do you really make your marketing plan such that the total money allocated is used effectively if you are spending both offline and online? So one of my thumb rules is very simple, is that still lot of persuasion is actually driven by offline. So if you want to create persuasion and preference for a brand, it is done offline. But if you actually want to do a lot of transaction and personalization, it is done online. Okay, so this is a very simple thumb rule which I have. I hope I have not said anything not in line with your calling. I'm not saying online is, I'm saying how do you get the money appropriately done or allocated. Okay. Again, I think all of you, I may look like a digital immigrant, but I work like a digital native. Okay, so this is a very interesting example which I have given. Around 2-3 years ago, all of you must have heard of this aeroplane coming in on the Hudson River in New York. It happened around 10 o'clock India, 10 p.m. India time. Yeah, and I was in front of the TV at my home. Within instant of a minute or second, I actually got the news and pictures, courtesy WhatsApp and Facebook and all my network. Actually on traditional media, which is the CNN and ABC and all, it came after 1 or 2 years. And Indian channels came after 3 years. So point I'm trying to make is that today's digital native is used to media consumption faster. Their requirement is much faster. So if we can't provide that, either as a media company or as a brand, then we are losing somewhere. Okay. This is one area we sometimes tend to miss. Logistics, the amount of digital transformation which is happening in logistics, we tend to miss. Okay. I think that's it. Rest are some of the other things. Thanks, guys.